Leave it to the Smashing Pumpkins to throw a total curveball at you with their sound. Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. I am Molly and in this video I'm going to be listening to the album Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness by the Smashing Pumpkins. Now this album I am so excited to hear. So many of you have been recommending it in the comments and apparently it's like the Smashing Pumpkins magnum opus, if you will. It's a double album, it's got a really long runtime, and supposedly this thing is just jam-packed with some great tracks. It was released 2 years after their second studio album Siamese Dream, which Siamese Dream I loved. It just had such a gorgeous sound to it, so many different styles kind of fused on one album. So I'm very intrigued now to check out Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness and just see what I'm gonna think of this one. Alright, so getting this album started is track one, which is the title track, Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness. A very relaxing start to this one. I love how this song is slowly expanding with its sound. They keep introducing new instruments. Well, that was track one, Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness. I guess they decided to get this album started with a purely acoustic track, just a very soft opener for the album. And that piano just had a really warm, rich tone to it, which I loved. But a really gorgeous start to this album. I'm curious to see how it's gonna kind of develop from there. But moving on to track two is Tonight, Tonight. Okay, right off the bat here, they're pulling in those orchestral elements on this track. This one has a much broader sound to it, though. It's got a little bit more of that dramatic flair going on. I love that percussion. It's reminiscent to me of just someone running, like down a street. I don't know why. There's something very cinematic about this song. I love the chord progression on the verses here. And then it's like that chorus just comes sweeping in. I love how this track is picking up intensity here at the end. That was track two, Tonight, Tonight. I got goosebumps there at the very end as it was ending. Just such a dramatic flair to that song. I loved how they were taking it from these really restrained verses and then it just slowly built up. I loved that percussion. It was like it just gradually increased speed and then the chorus just came in with all of this grandiosity. Moving on to track three is Jelly Belly. These guitars have a really great intensity to them. I love how there's these like really quick, sudden bursts going on from the guitar. It's giving this track a really speedy quality. It's almost like dropping a bunch of rocks in a lake and then all of these ripples are spreading out. This one is certainly bringing the intensity, that's for sure. Well, that was track three, Jelly Belly. Definitely a change-up on this album. That one was bringing a lot of punchiness to it. The first two tracks kind of gently introduced you to that album. They had this sort of relaxing quality to them with that orchestral instrumentation, and then that one definitely brought more of a rock edge, a ton of speediness. Those guitars, to me, were the star of the show. They just had a really rich, deep tone to them, which I loved. But moving on to track four is Zero. Yeah, I'm really liking the guitars on this album. They're really shining. Just like me. There's something about the vocal delivery just there that kind of reminded me a little bit of System of a Down. Just how they were stopping the song like that, and it was just his vocals for short little periods. Here we go with the crazy guitar sounds again. Smashing Pumpkins always delivers on the weird creativity with their music. That was track four, Zero. I really enjoyed that one. Another kind of more punchy, upbeat track for sure, just bringing the energy. I really like how Billy, their lead singer, changes his voice up so much. He can bring a lot of intensity to it, more of a rock edge, but then he can make it really tender and gentle and restrained too. And he just strikes a perfect balance between those two aspects to his voice. And on that track, he was definitely bringing more of that aggressiveness. Moving on to track five is Here Is No Why. I love the rhythm of this song. The way they're doing these guitars, it's somehow gentle, but they have this way of abruptly stopping the guitar, which gives it this weird sort of bouncy quality. And that percussion, it's almost like someone knocking on a door. Nice little guitar solo going on here. Yeah, see what I mean with his voice? Like this song, he's bringing that growliness, more intensity to it. Well, that was track five, Here Is No Why. My favorite thing about that one was the rhythm they were creating with those guitars. On the verses especially, that really came through. It was like this sharp back and forth quality that was so much fun. And then it kind of transitioned seamlessly into the chorus, which was a little bit smoother, and it kind of opened up with its sound. And then all of a sudden they would bring that sharpness right back to the verse. I loved how they were doing that. But moving on to track six is Bullet With Butterfly Wings. The world is a vampire. I've heard this song. Percussion. Yeah, for sure I've heard this one. I guess I just never realized it was Smashing Pumpkins. I love how punchy this chorus is. They're bringing a lot of tension to this song on the verses here, how they're building it up. Oh, Dang, I don't remember this part of the song. There's almost this staticky noise going on too. Jesus wasn't all this song. Despite all my rage, I am still just a rat in a cage. I love how he's saying he's in a cage despite all of his rage. And the song is almost mimicking that. It's like the rage comes out on the chorus. There's so much energy, but the verse is so restrained, and there's that tension I was talking about, which is kind of like he's being caged up, like he has to hold it all in. That was track 6, Bullet with Butterfly Wings. I guess I have heard a song off of Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness because I have 100% heard that one before. So much punchiness. I love it. And those verses are such a contrast with the chorus. They just do a fantastic job on that track of building it up really slowly. You can hear all of the layers being added. And then that chorus just has such an impact when it comes through. Up next is track 7, which is called To Forgive. Alright, they're definitely slowing things down on this one compared to that last track. And is that an organ that I'm hearing faintly in the background? Some harmonizing here, it sounds like. There's such a lushness to this song. There's a really strong warmth and rich tone to the instrumentals. That was track 7, To Forgive. A really soft track. It kind of lulled me into this really relaxing place, just so gentle with its sound. And yet they were still fusing on like these glimmers of effects and experimentation, but it just was done in a really subtle way. It almost reminded me of being on a boat out in the middle of a lake on a warm summer day and just kind of gently rocking back and forth. Up next is track 8 called An Ode to No One. I love the subtle little echo there on his vocals. The guitar and the drums are just like this steady, continuous noise going on. It's bringing a lot of intensity to this track. Destroy the mind, destroy the body, but you cannot destroy the heart. I love how he said, "I don't need your love to disconnect." And then right then the song stopped for a second. It was like the song disconnected. I love when the way the song sounds mimics the vocals. Tongue around a bumblebee mouth. Give it all back to you. No way, not needed. These guitars have this sort of fuzziness to them. It's like they're slightly distorted or something. Yeah! That was track 8, An Ode to No One. So many fun things with that one. It changed up on me a lot. It did a lot of things I was not expecting at all with its sound. It had that certain, like, aggressive speediness to it, but they would stop the song at parts. It just kind of threw me for a loop on a couple of occasions listening to it. I love music that always throws unexpected stuff at you. But I'm gonna move on to track 9, which is called Love. Right off the bat, this one has a different tone to it. It's just so much distortion going on. It's got this fuzziness to it. There's so many elements going on with the sound on this one. At points, it almost sounds like there's electronic stuff they're doing. And I'm picking up on the sound from the percussion too. It almost sounds like a clock ticking. Do you hear that sound going on behind the guitar and all that distortion? It's like a synth or something. It has a strong electronic quality to its tone. That was track 9, Love. That one really stood out to me so far on this album. It had a very distinctly different tone. A ton of distortion, a sort of fuzziness to it, but so many layers going on. It almost reminds me of if you take a handful of Skittles and put them all in your mouth at once. There's all these different flavors and you can pick up on each one individually, but at the same time, it kind of all creates a new flavor going on just because there's so many different elements being utilized. Moving on to track 10 is Cupid de Locke. Wow, I love the tone of this one. Again, there's such a warm and lush quality to it with that harp and everything. That really subtle beeping almost from the percussion. Like all of these little things they infuse on, it's what makes their music really stand out. This is a beautiful song. There's just such a radiance to it. That was track 10, Cupid de Locke. Definitely a sharp transition between that last song, Love, that had all of that distortion, kind of like a My Bloody Valentine-esque quality to its sound. And then that one, Cupid de Locke, was so gentle and warm and rich and didn't really have any distortion at all. And I loved the use of the harp on that one too. Again, just bringing such a warmth to that song. But moving on to track 11 is Galapagos. Bass is so subtle, but it brings such an impact to this song here at the start. Pretend we're still a child. There's something about this one that is reminding me a little bit of Disarm off of Siamese Dream. There's just kind of a slight similarity to their tone. There's a certain sadness almost to this song, a sort of melancholy, if you will. Okay, now we've got kind of an ambient quality going on here. Never mind. That was track 11, Galapagos. Such a gentle calmness to it, and yet, like I said, it kind of had that mournful quality to its tone at the same time. And I loved his voice on that one, really smooth, and yet he kind of brings a yearning to it at points as well. And I liked, too, how they were kind of introducing those orchestral elements that some other tracks on this album have really emphasized. They were utilizing those, but in a pretty subtle way. I just like how that track kind of kept everything contained, and it was so gentle and relaxing. But moving on to track 12 is Muzzle. I love their ability to go back and forth so much between the gentle calming tracks, like that last one, and then this one that's bringing more of that punchy energy. There's certainly a lot of themes regarding love on this album. I'm always bad with lyrics on the first listen through, but the few I've picked up on have definitely emphasized a lot of emotions surrounding love. That was track 12, Muzzle. I think it's interesting it's called Muzzle, and he was saying, I knew the silence of the world, and a muzzle you kind of put on something to silence it. But that track, to me, just fused a really great smooth kind of gentleness with his vocal delivery, but then the percussion I noticed just brought a lot of punchiness to that track, and again, it was like a contradiction of sounds, but it just worked beautifully as one track, very cohesive sounding. Up next is track 13, which is called Porcelina of the Vast Oceans. It's just very quiet at the start here. I'm not hearing anything. Okay, now some really subtle instrumentation is being introduced. Such a clear tone to that noise just there. I was not expecting that. Leave it to the Smashing Pumpkins to throw a total curveball at you with their sound. There's a slight distortion on his vocals I'm picking up on. It's like this really subtle, almost crackly sound. How are they even making those sounds? It's something with the percussion they're doing. That's such a cool effect. Just there, he said lullabies, and then in the background I heard the second really soft vocal going on. The more aggressive parts of this song have such a sharpness to them, and then when they pull it in again, it's got this sort of floaty, atmospheric, outer spacey quality to it. That was track 13, Poor Selena of the Vast Oceans. It started off completely silent, actually, and then it just slowly came in, the sound of that song. It kind of reminded me of the tide coming in and then going back out. But just all of the stuff they were doing on that one, how it started so calm and then all of a sudden that really punchy rock element came in out of nowhere, that definitely threw me for a loop with that one. And I just love the contrast that they keep doing on this whole album. That song really played up that contrast. But moving on to track 14 is Take Me Down. Is this Billy Corgan on vocals? It almost sounds like a different singer. All I see is you. Yet again with this song, it's like you're being rocked back and forth, just being put in a trance. Will you help me understand? Again, such a rich tone to this song. That was track 14, Take Me Down. Beautiful song. It almost just put me in this sort of spellbound state from the sound of that one. Such a warmth to it, like a radiance coming through with the instrumentals. It didn't have any of that distortion. It just had a really, really clear tone to it. All right, so now we are officially done with side one of Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness. So moving on to side two is the first track, which is called Where Boys Fear to Tread. I can sense this song is building up to something. I just heard like a beeping sound. There's such a heaviness to this song. Got these really continuous instrumentals, but they're doing so much behind them. All kinds of effects and everything. I can't even tell. Is that a guitar? There's this sound I keep picking up on that's like a whistle going on faintly in the background. That was track one, Where Boys Fear to Tread. Definitely a heaviness to that one, which I liked. It kind of had a grunge quality to it almost. And the track just had this really steady quality to it. It was very consistent with the main instrumentals going on, but then all of the effects that they were doing were absolutely enthralling to listen to. Half the time I didn't really know what I was hearing. Just a lot going on sonically with that one. Definitely a track they were having a lot of fun with. But I'm gonna move on to track two, which is called Bodies. So much intensity to this one. It's got a sort of speediness to it, which I'm liking. Love is suicide. So again, they're bringing that theme of love onto part two of this album. There's so much intensity to his vocals on this one. Man, this might be the most aggressive I've ever heard Billy's voice on all of the Smashing Pumpkins stuff I've heard so far. Now he drank the night. All my right? They're doing some layering here with the vocals. That was track 2, Bodies. I absolutely loved that one. It had so much intensity to it. On their previous two albums, Gish and Siamese Dream, they definitely had intense moments, don't get me wrong. But I think on Melancholy, they're bringing a little bit more of a punchiness almost to their sound, which I'm really enjoying. But just a fantastic track. I loved his vocals on that one, paired with those instrumentals. It just retained this really quick smoothness, and yet it brought so much of an impact to its sound at the same time. Okay, moving on to track 3. Is 33. Such an interesting tone from that guitar here at the beginning. Some really faint harmonization going on. It's hard to tell if they've got a second vocalist or if they're just layering up his vocals. I can never really tell. This track is really interesting. You have more of a soft acoustic quality up front and center, but there's this really clean, kind of futuristic sound I keep picking up on more in the background. It's fusing like this warm, kind of organic quality with a more cold, like futuristic one. That was track 3, 33. I absolutely loved how atmospheric that one was. It had this really great soundscape going on. In fact, it almost reminded me a little bit of Heaven or Las Vegas by Cocteau Twins. I recently listened to that album, and it kind of had a similar atmosphere going on, like this really rich, lush soundscape. I loved how acoustic that one was, but they were fusing on these sound effects in the background that added more to that song. They really helped kind of elevate it beyond just a simple acoustic track. But I'm going to move on to track 4, which is called In the Arms of Sleep. There's such a twanginess to this one. It's like a very pronounced acoustic guitar they're using. From an instrumental standpoint, if you played this song to me, like without Billy's vocals, I could not tell you this was Smashing Pumpkins. It has almost a country element to its sound. I just heard something in the background. I don't know if it was some sort of reverb or twanginess or something from the guitar. I just heard it for a split second. It's so faint. I don't know what that sound is. Right now, for you. That was track 4, In the Arms of Sleep. They definitely picked the right track title for that one. It was just like it was rocking you to sleep with this gentle back and forth quality. Again, a more subtle acoustic track, way less punchiness to it. It almost had a sort of country twang to it, like I said, just a really interesting sound. Up next is track 5, which is called 1979. Okay, this is another one I've heard. This intro is instantly recognizable. I love that weird distortion. There just is such a smooth tone all of a sudden on this chorus. These noises too that come in really subtly in the background on the chorus, they have this weird sort of squeakiness to them. It's hard to explain. It's almost like unoiled hinges or something. All right, there's some distortion going on here with the vocals. Man, this song is just brilliant. It's such a perfect blend of everything going on. I don't know exactly how to articulate that. Like, everything is so balanced. That was track 5, 1979. Yet another one on this album that apparently I have heard. That one for sure was instantly recognizable right at the start there. Just so smooth though. Man, I absolutely love the little inflections of distortion and twang in the background, but they just keep it all so polished and precise at the same time. It's kind of gentle on the verse, and then when that chorus hits, it's like his voice just gets so smooth and expansive. It's like he draws his words out more. But up next is track 6, which is Tales of a Scorched Earth. This is like some Mike Patton vocals going on here, man. Man, it almost sounds like laser beams shooting around. There's something about this song too. The vocals sound really muffled, like they're kind of pushed more into the background. It's almost like they're being drowned out a little bit by all of this instrumentation coming at you. Well, that was track 6, Tales of a Scorched Earth. That might be the most punchy moment I've heard from Smashing Pumpkins so far in their discography. Like I said, it was kind of reminiscent of Mike Patton to me, like something along the lines of Mr. Bungle, just very creative, very playful, and again with kind of that fuzziness. It was almost like that track was muffled a bit with its sound, even though it was this barrage of energy coming at you. It kind of had a weird softness to it at the same time, just because of that muffledness. Alright, so moving on to track 7 now is Through the Eyes of Ruby. I love how clear all of these instrumentals are. It sounds like what sun sparkling on water looks like, if that makes sense. Like, there's no distortion really on this one at all. Breathing underwater. Kind of interesting, I just mentioned how it kind of sounds like water a little bit. I love how this song is slowly growing in sound. I love that sort of garbled, clear tone I keep hearing. It's kind of electronic sounding. It almost gives this song like this underwater sort of feeling to it. They just keep adding so many layers to this song, man. It just keeps building up and up. know this might sound like a weird comparison, but for some reason, like, the progression of this song is reminding me a lot of Passenger by Deftones. Like, not necessarily the mood of it or the atmosphere, that's a little bit different, but just how it's so drawn out and they build it up so gradually. I don't know, it's reminding me a little bit of Passenger in that sense. Kind of an unexpected little acoustic ending here. That was track 7, Through the Eyes of Ruby. I absolutely loved the start of that one. It had this very crystalline, clear, water-like quality to it. And then they gradually built that song up and they ended up bringing a ton of punchiness to that one. And the electric guitar and everything they infused on there. It was almost like the sound of that one just started to overtake you, but you didn't even realize it because it was so methodically and slowly done. But I'm going to continue on with track 8, which is called Stumbling. If I'm saying that right. Bottoms in the bathroom, shaking out the loose tea. All Our Dreams Lost at Sea. I've said earlier how this album is definitely embracing a lot of lyrical themes surrounding love, and I'm also picking up on a lot surrounding water as well, like the ocean and the sea. His voice is interesting on this one. It'll sound really clear, and then for a second it'll kind of fade a little bit. It's almost like when he was recording it, he was moving closer and then further away from the microphone or something. It's an interesting effect. I'll be a super queen. Come around, Ruby. I can never sleep alone. That was track 8, Stumbling. I think it's interesting how that one ended with the line, "Come around, Ruby, I could never sleep at home." And the last track was called Through the Eyes of Ruby. It's almost like tracks 7 and 8 kind of piggyback off of each other in a sense. But that one was such a beautiful, kind of minimalistic acoustic track. I loved that guitar, just a great tone to it. It had this really gentle, relaxed quality to it, but yet there was like this little twinge of melancholy too. All right, moving on to track 9 is XYU. Love that percussion right at the beginning. It sounded very metallic. I absolutely love how unleashed Billy is with his vocals on this album. Not that he necessarily held back on Gish or Siamese Dream, but he's just bringing the energy on Melancholy, and I'm loving it. There's like a snarl to his voice, man. It sounds like you're sinking down. There's that garbled sound too in the background. It's kind of like you're trying to breathe underwater, like you're slowly drowning. This song is getting so speedy, my God. This is kind of like sludge metal at this point. It's just got such a heaviness to its tone. Just when I thought that track couldn't get any more wild, it ends like that. But But that was track 9, XYU. That one brought so much intensity. Man, I absolutely loved it. That percussion was for sure standing out. Like I said, it kind of had this clangy industrial coldness to it. And his vocal delivery was absolutely crazy on that one too. I keep saying throughout this album, like, oh, this is the most intense I've heard his voice. But so far, I think XYU takes the cake. That one was just insane. So much energy and aggression coming out in his voice. But I'm gonna move on now to track 10, which is We Only Come Out At Night. At this point, I just don't know what to expect. Now it sounds like a rubber ball or something bouncing up and down. We only come out. There's such a playfulness to this one. It's got a really carefree sound to it. Those little bursts of, I don't even know what that is, if it's a guitar or what sort of instrumentation they're using. It just reminds me of a sunbeam just shooting all of this light and warmth onto this song. That was track 10, We Only Come Out At Night. Something about that boingy effect and that weird guitar sound or whatever I was talking about and the piano, it just had a very almost childlike sort of carefree playfulness to it. Very relaxed, and especially after that last song, XYU, it was kind of like a little needed break on this album. Okay, moving on to track 11 is Beautiful. There's something about the rhythm of this one that is actually kind of reminding me of the song Teardrop by Massive Attack. There's like a slight similarity there. There's such a happy tone to this song. It's like putting a smile on my face listening to it. It's just got a really beautiful warmth to it. So Let the Clouds Roll Back. Yeah, I love how sunny this song sounds. Again, the tone of it is definitely lining up with the lyrics. All of these chimes and things too that they're throwing on is just yet again adding to that sort of fresh, summery, happy feeling that this song has. That was track 11, Beautiful. I really liked how that one ended. That song just put a smile on my face. It brought so much joy and a lightness to this album. But then at the very end, with it fading out like that, it's as if you kind of had a grasp of happiness for the duration of that track, but then it floated away from you, and it was like you was just kind of disappearing into outer space. I really, really enjoyed how they did that, though, with just the sound of that song. They conjured up an entire image and feeling in my body, which I just think is so fascinating. But I'm gonna move on to track 12, which is called Lily, My One and Only. I love how soft and kind of muffled this percussion sounds. Right, is this a violin now that's coming in? That that was track 12, Lily, My One and Only. There was kind of a subtle quirkiness to that one in a way. It kind of had this really laid back, playful tone to it with that piano. It brought a nice little melodic touch to this album, and the last few tracks have kind of brought a lighter tone, more of a joyfulness to the sound of this album. So I'm curious to see how these last two songs are going to finish it off. So moving on to track 13 is By Starlight. I love how that distortion all of a sudden just ended. There's such a softness to this song. It has this really, really mild, sort of muffled quality to it. The song is almost making me a little bit choked up listening to it. It just has this beautiful atmosphere. I'm really getting caught up in the lyrics too. It's so clear sounding. His vocal delivery on this one too is so smooth. It's just like you're floating through outer space or something. That was track 13, By Starlight. That one was just breathtaking in my opinion. Beautiful, beautiful song. So smooth and sort of enveloping with its sound. And yet there was something really mournful about that one too. I'm noticing that a lot on this album. It kind of fits with the title of the album, Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness. But I am really curious to see how this album is going to finish off. So last up we have track 14, which is called Farewell and Goodnight. There's like these swishy sounds I'm hearing in the background. It almost sounds like a paper cutter in an office. That's what it's reminding me of. Is this a second vocalist? How many vocalists are on this song? I keep hearing these different voices. I'm like, do they have more than two singers? I love how the guitar on this track has this sort of like modern, borderline electronic twang going on with its sound. Now this piano here at the end, it just sounds like stars in the night sky. It's such a clear, crisp sound. Well, that was track 14, Farewell and Goodnight. I guess they decided to end Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness on a pretty acoustic note. That one was very pulled in. The vocalists, though, on that one threw me for a loop because I was definitely picking up on Billy's voice, but then it sounded like there was a second male vocalist and a female vocalist as well. But really, really beautiful, again, with that kind of lulling you to sleep, like back and forth quality to its sound, and just a very gentle track to end this album on. Well, that concludes my reaction to Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness by the Smashing Pumpkins. 5 hours of filming and 4 camera batteries and 2 cups of coffee later, here we are. This thing was a very, very long album, but I honestly loved every second of it. They still managed to fuse on so many different sounds and a lot of experimentation, and they always kept things really fresh and new with every track. I would say with one listen, my initial favorites are probably probably track two on the first side, Tonight. That one just had a really gorgeous tone to it, kind of a grandiosity with the orchestral instrumentation that they utilized. And another standout for me on the first side of this album was track 9, Love. That one they used so much distortion, it made it really stand out as a track. And then on the second side of Melancholy, track 2, Bodies, I absolutely loved how speedy and aggressive that one was. It brought a lot of energy. And track 5, 1979, like I said in my reaction, I've actually heard that one, but that is just such a beautiful song. I love that kind of watery distortion on the vocals at parts. And then track 13 by Starlight, too, just had such a soft sort of melancholy sound to it that kind of made me emotional. I really enjoyed that one. But man, Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness, this thing was just incredible from start to finish, and I really enjoyed hearing all of these different aspects to the Smashing Pumpkins sound. Definitely let me know in the comments if you want me to continue on with Smashing Pumpkins and hear more of their stuff. And yeah, as usual, thank you all so much for watching. Stay tuned, and I will see you in the next video.